Hi, this is Dr. Nimichek. I want to talk to you about bacterial overgrowth and why it relapses, what causes relapses, at least from what we can tell. So, one, bacterial overgrowth, what is this? Well, we're talking about when, you know, I talk about the separation of bacteria, what I call the bird bacteria in the small intestine, the fish bacteria in the colon. You have a 1 to 100 million ratio of these bacteria. And things can break down where the bacteria in the colon are now living in the small intestine. Now, this is in many corners called SIBO, small intestine bacterial overgrowth. That's defined as having a positive breath test. They've got this test. It's defined as maybe they take a scope in and they culture it, but they can quantify how many bacteria per milliliter in there. Very difficult things to do. The breath test is not real accurate. You know, people think of a test kind of like a calculator where 2 + 2 always equals 4. Well, this breath test is 25% of the time 2 + 2 equals 5, all right, or 3, not 4. And so it leads to a lot of confusion, okay, and that's why we don't even use it here. I feel like I'm much more accurate just clinically dealing with the patients. And so I just like to call it intestinal bacterial overgrowth and not use SIBO because everybody gets caught up in the breath test part of that. So now, basically, so when you have the fish bacteria living up here with the birds and we use Rifaximin, or generically known as Rifaximin, you get, in a large proportion of patients, recovery. All right, now you get reorganization of that. Intestinal symptoms go away if they were having them. Brain function gets better, a bunch of things are good. Now, this can relapse, all right? So there's a couple reasons why this relapses. One is we have that low biodiversity thing I've talked about, and that's where with great-grandma, she had been born with 100% of the bacteria we should have. We should have about 1,100 species of bacteria, and that's been passed from mother to child for probably 3 million years. And grandma lost a few percentage points of her bacteria from antibiotics and pesticides. And then, you know, so great grandma loses some. So grandma's born with fewer than she should have, say 95%. And then she's exposed to stuff. And so your mom's born with 90% instead of 95%. And now you're born with 85%. So you have this decreasing species count we call low biodiversity. So one of the things that can cause relapse is really low biodiversity. And we see this in recurrent Clostridial difficile colitis, or enterocolitis, otherwise known as C. diff. The lower the species count, the more apt you get overgrowth of C. diff, all right? And we believe that it's the same for other instances. So that's pretty low species count in those patients. Another common thing is a big course of antibiotics, or just a course of antibiotics, you know, and these, most of the common antibiotics we use are broad spectrum. They just jack up, you know, one of the things that's keeping this balance is all the bacteria kind of keeping each other in check. So you slam into it with some antibiotics, jacks things up, and now next thing you know, you got birds living up where the fish are, okay? So no bueno. So antibiotics can do that. Now sometimes there's nothing you can do. You got pneumonia, you need the antibiotics, otherwise you might die, all right? So I'm not about don't use antibiotics. I'm just talking about what things can make this relapse. So we got low biodiversity, we got antibiotics. And then a very common thing that's not really discussed much is your intestinal tract is like an intestinal conveyor belt, all right? It has a motility from the esophagus to the stomach. There's a certain speed that happens. From the stomach emptying, there's a certain speed that happens. From the small intestine moving and the colon moving, there's a certain speed. These things all move apart. We know anything that slows down the motility of the small intestine in particular, all right, relapse. So what are these things? It could be a concussion. It can be an emotional concussion, a physical concussion. It could be an inflammatory concussion, like from a vaccine or surgery, okay? It can be general anesthesia. This is pretty common, especially when they're going in the abdominal cavity. So for instance, if they take out your gallbladder or you have a hysterectomy, about 40% of the patients will have the worst form of SIBO you can have just from that. And because the addition, it's not just general anesthesia in these cases, but they go in and they got to move the intestines around. And when you touch the intestines, they almost short circuit. We call this an ileus. And for those of you who had your gallbladder out, the nurses are saying, you got to walk around, make sure they get, you have to have a bowel movement before they're going to let you go, because they want to see the motility starting again. Okay. Gastric stomach resection for some conditions. About 50% have the worst form of bacterial overgrowth with that, okay? Possibly C-sections. I just haven't seen any data on that in particular. So things that slow it down, general anesthesia, brain injuries, some antibiotics. So, I mean, some medicines, excuse me, not antibiotics, like maybe pain medicines are known to slow down the gut. They might do it. There's some medical conditions. So there's a autoimmune disorder called scleroderma, which is very well known to do that. Chronic renal failure is associated with a slow intestinal motility and a high incidence of SIBO. So a variety of things that can do that too. All right. Then potentially there's other things we don't even know that can do this. But the biggies that you can see in my practice are low biodiversity, antibiotics, or things that slow the gut down. And so you'll see in a case like in the US guidelines, they talk about for using the antibiotics, Rifaximin, to fix diarrhea in IBS. So IBS with diarrhea is bad SIBO with autonomic dysfunction that causes a slow motility of the gut and sets you up for a relapse. So what do we see there? These people relapse about every 2 to 3 months. Well, sure, you haven't fixed the underlying problem, it's the slow motility. But if you can get the autonomics to work, you can get that to recover. So I've had some patients where maybe they need Rifaximin every 2 or 3 months, and we're doing that at the same time we're fixing the autonomic nervous system. And they may go, say, every 2 months you get Rifaximin, another 2 months get Rifaximin, another 2 months to get Rifaximin, and then all of a sudden they go 6 months without a relapse. And then the next round is a year or longer. Once you get to the brain, this kind of tipping point, the nervous system functions better, the relapses stop. Now, at any point in there, you can get some antibiotics maybe for a bladder infection, have a relapse. But in general, if that's not happening, we'll see as the brain recovers, as we see their autonomic symptoms recover, as we see their autonomic tests recover, the likelihood of SIBO is greatly, greatly reduced, okay? Now, for the low biodiversity, when it's really low, like in recurrent C. diff, one of the things that helps those people is a fecal transplant. And there you can actually increase somebody's biodiversity. You won't get them to normal at all, but you can improve it enough that that will lessen that risk as well. So that's all for SIBO relapse or bacterial overgrowth relapse. This is Dr. Nemechek of the Nemechek Protocol, Buckeye, Arizona. Take care.